and energy efficiency. You have that. So to start my conference with my position as a minister with a beautiful conference on energy efficiency, because I have been on this side almost all my life. I taught pumps, I learned about hydraulic turbines, but I switched from turbines to pumps and to use, efficient use of energy at the Civil Engineering University. The problem we had all the time was the financing problem. Who's giving us the money? Who's financing this thing? And that's the reason why I emphasized from the very beginning, from the very moment I came to the Minister of Energy, that we are not only following and keeping an eye and monitoring the production of energy, but on the same level, we are monitoring and following the reduction of energy consumption, the increase of efficiency in energy usage. You know that Romania has a fairly balanced mix of energy production. We are producing energy out of coal, we are producing energy out of gas, we are producing energy out of nuclear systems, we are having wind, fairly big wind energy production. We are having a fairly important solar energy production. We are increasing our biomass production, energy production. But in that, we don't have to forget that Romania is making serious efforts in reducing the energy, the useless energy consumption, or in increasing the efficiency in two directions. One is urban, and in urban direction we are putting some plastic things, I don't care about exactly about the term, but we are trying to insulate the buildings, which is a fairly big program and it does cost a lot. We have found some solutions, we are seeking for better solutions, and we have good results of that. You know, and I'm talking not about the official figures and so on, I'm talking about the impression of the general public, which is living in the high-rise apartment buildings, and it's telling all the time, yes, we have had a reduction of costs and a better environment. Then, heating and cooling, because Romania, as you probably know, because we are here with the neighbors, and the neighbors have the same situation. The summers are hot and the winters are very cold, so we have a great discrepancy between summer and winter, and we need heating systems and cooling systems, which have to be more and more efficient. We have, and we started to change the street lighting. And if you want, we have a nice example in Alba Iulia, which is unfortunately singular, but it has to be replicated in all the country. And we need money for that. And not only money, but financing schemes. And we need efficient transportation. Fortunately, we did not throw out the streetcars as somebody tried to do in former times, and we can use them, and we can develop the streetcar system and the trolleys and the metro and so on. But again, this needs financial scheme. And why do I say that? I remember a nice group of studies made by finance, by Siemens, about the cities and the energy efficiency in the cities, where the graphs, I tried to explain for my students was, were like that. Some of the measures are self-sustaining in a number of years, and some of the measures need some supplementary investment because they are not self-sustaining. There will not be a fair return in a number of years, 5, 10, and so on. Then we have to convince population to do that. You know, I have a joke. Do you know why on the water taps these aerators have been introduced? Or probably most of you know. It's a nice trick. We're using less water and giving the impression of the usage of high quantity of water, so the people who are using it are content. On the other hand, we have to discuss about industrial pumps, water pumps, fans, compressors, which have to be efficient and have to be more and more efficient because they are the main consumers, the main industrial consumers. And that is something which we have to have enormous or a clever, shall I say, financing scheme in order to improve, to change the pumps. In water systems, for example, in Romania, we had a dramatic decrease of water consumed per capita. And that meant immediately a dramatic change in the performances necessary, optimum performances of pumps. I will not tell you more things about that. I want to emphasize only that I believe in SMEs. I believe that SMEs have a crucial role in that. And I think that this conference will be a good opportunity for everybody. I would love this conference to be broadcasted and to be, you know, made more known in the engineering field, not only engineering, the business field. And I wish you all a very successful conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. So now I introduce to you Ms. Mihaela Tatăr, my colleague, State Secretary in the Ministry of Regional Development and Public Administration, to address his message. Welcome.
Bună dimineața și vă mulțumim pentru invitație. Pentru noi este o oportunitate extraordinară să putem veni și să putem prezenta intervențiile pe care fondurile structurale și de investiție le pot finanța în domeniul eficienței energetice și de ce nu să auzim ideile dumneavoastră, pentru că ne apropiem de cadrul multianual următor, ne apropiem de post-2020 și desigur acolo probabil că va fi locul în care ideile dumneavoastră și nevoile pe care mediul de afaceri și partea publică le au în domeniul eficienței energetice, ar trebui să se regăsească. Prin urmare, pentru Ministerul Fondurilor Europene, este o oportunitate să venim astăzi aici, să vă ascultăm, pentru că noi considerăm că trebuie să fim pregătiți, nu numai pentru ceea ce ni se întâmplă în zilele noastre, să spunem așa, cât mai ales pentru ceea ce va fi post-2020, având în vedere schimbările anticipate, nu numai în termen bugetar, dar și în termen de așteptări ale cetățenilor europeni din perspectiva fondurilor europene. Însă, dincolo de a vorbi de viitor, aș vrea să vă vorbesc despre prezent, să vă vorbesc despre ceea ce noi am programat, e adevărat, la nivelul anului 2014, la începutul exercițiului financiar în domeniul eficienței energetice, și să vă ascultăm ideile, pentru că nimic nu este permanent, Și acolo unde există suficientă flexibilitate și suficientă dorință de a face, credem că putem veni cu toții în întâmpinarea nevoilor societății, astfel încât investițiile din fonduri europene să se dovedească a fi utile, utile cetățenilor, dincolo de cifrele extrem de seci care se referă la absorpție. Și ne dorim să nu ne mai măsurăm succesul în, neapărat în cifre de absorpție, cât mai ales în, în investiții durabile. Profit de unul din aspectele pe care domnul ministru le-a subliniat, și anume că în ceea ce privește eficiența energetică, sigur, mediul de afaceri este extrem de important, însă la nivelul orașelor există zone unde, care nu se pot susține singure, acolo unde nu există acest efect de revolving, să spunem, care ar putea aduce investiții private neapărat în, în domeniul eficienței energetice. Și acolo este locul în care fondurile europene și intervenția statului trebuie să fie prezente, astfel încât să reușim să acoperim această lipsă de finanțare pentru anumite investiții. Și aici mă refer în primul rând la eficiența energetică în clădiri rezidențiale. Deci acolo unde cetățenii, din păcate, cu fondul locativ, așa cum arată în România în acest moment, nu se pot susține în absența granturilor, astfel încât să-și transforme locuințele în locuințe eficiente energetice și să crească nivelul de trai și nivelul de satisfacție al populației. Și, desigur, vorbim de eficiența energetică în clădiri publice. Vorbim iarăși de un fond de clădiri publice vechi, inclusiv în ceea ce privește infrastructura de bază, și aici mă refer în special spitale, școli, instituții, mă rog, de cultură, care au nevoie de investiții serioase, pe de o parte pentru a fi eficiente energetic și pe de altă parte pentru a putea oferi condiții de siguranță cetățenilor care au nevoie de serviciile ce se desfășoară în aceste locuri. Prin urmare, prin programul operațional regional au fost alocate aproape 1 miliard de euro pentru aceste două tipuri de investiții în eficiență energetică. Vorbim exclusiv de granturi, deci nu vorbim încă de instrumente financiare în acest domeniu. Deja apelurile au fost deschise încă din anul 2016 și redeschise în anul 2017. În ceea ce privește eficiența energetică la clădiri rezidențiale, avem un grad satisfăcător de proiecte depuse. În ceea ce privește eficiența la clădiri publice, pot să spun că suntem aproape de linia maximă, cu mici excepții, respectiv București, Ilfov, domeniul care va fi relansat. De asemenea, plecând de la cerințele regulamentelor europene la momentul programării, ne-am gândit și am negociat cu partenerii noștri din Comisia Europeană utilizarea și altor fonduri în mod complementar pentru domeniul eficienței energetice. Și aici mă refer la sumele pe care le-am alocat prin Programul Operațional Infrastructură Mare pentru sistemele de distribuție și de transport energie termică, un loc unde, într-adevăr, este nevoie de investiții serioase. E adevărat că sursele din fonduri europene sunt limitate, nu pot acoperi chiar toate nevoile, însă ne-am propus să susținem pe lângă municipiul București alte 7 orașe care au beneficiat inițial prin Programul Operațional Sectorial Mediu de investiții pentru aceste tipuri de sisteme, și ne-am dorit să continuăm aceste investiții, astfel încât la final cel puțin aceste 7 orașe să aibă un sistem de distribuție și de transport al energiei termice eficient energetic. Mai mult decât atât, Strategia de Specializare Inteligentă a României a identificat printre domeniile de specializare inteligentă domeniul energiei. Acolo cred că este locul în care ar trebui să ne gândim la viitor, și acolo cred că este locul unde întreprinderile mici și mijlocii pot să-și îmbunătățească nivelul de cunoștințe, de sisteme până la urmă de aplicare și inovare, astfel încât să devină mai eficiente energetic. Sigur, există o discuție și de asta spun că această discuție poate fi redeschisă chiar și în acest cadru financiar, legat de eficiență energetică în întreprindere. la momentul negocierilor începute în anul 2012, Comisia a prezentat un document de poziție pentru, în ceea ce privește nevoile pe care au considerat că România le-ar avea în toate domeniile finanțate din fonduri europene structurale și de investiții. Domeniul eficienței energetice fiind într-adevăr un domeniu subliniat și în acest document de poziție. Însă, la momentul respectiv s-a considerat că investițiile în eficiența energetică la întreprinderi nu ar trebui să fie, ar trebui să fie un scop mediat și nu un scop imediat. Scopul imediat al oricărei întreprinderi ar trebui să fie creșterea competitivității, scăderea costurilor în mod evident, astfel încât să devii mult mai competitiv în piață, ceea ce ar aduce de la sine o creștere a eficienței energetice în instalațiile, în tehnologia pe care întreprinderile respective o folosesc. Prin urmare, acesta a fost și motivul pentru care, deși la momentul respectiv, să spunem, poziția României nu a fost aceeași, a fost un proces de negociere și așa cum este dintr-un proces de negociere, am ajuns undeva la mijloc, să spun așa, pentru că noi susținem într-adevăr întreprinderile mici și mijlocii prin program operațional regional, energia fiind de asemenea un domeniu competitiv și este unul din domeniile pe care noi le susținem, cu sume considerabile, cel puțin conform ultimei realocări, am reușit să acoperim întreaga cerere de proiecte pe domeniul IMM-urilor. Însă, dacă vorbim de oportunități de finanțare, poate este momentul să ne gândim, în mod corect, nu neapărat la o schemă de granturi, cât poate la un instrument financiar destinat întreprinderilor mici și mijlocii și, de ce nu, poate și întreprinderilor mari, în măsura în care avem această flexibilitate relativ redusă la nivelul regulamentului, să finanțăm eficiența energetică în întreprindere. Poate cu o serie de condiții de competitivitate, poate cu o serie de condiții de, să spun, de utilizare inovativă a noilor instrumente. E, poate că este un subiect de discuție și m-aș bucura ca astăzi, pentru că văd în sală foarte mulți dintre partenerii noștri de la momentul 2014, când discutam acordul de parteneriat, poate este un moment oportun să deschidem această discuție și, repet, poate, chiar dacă suntem în plină implementare a cadrului financiar 2014-2020, din păcate sau din fericire, nu știu cum să spun, 2020 este foarte aproape. Și atunci și deschiderea negocierilor este iarăși și mai aproape, pentru că ne așteptăm ca la începutul anului 2019 să intrăm în linie dreaptă. Și atunci poate că este momentul oportun în care să vedem dacă avem nevoie de o schimbare de paradigmă. Este piața pregătită? Sunt IMM-urile pregătite pentru un instrument financiar pe eficiență energetică? Este piața IMM-urilor mai dornică de eficiență energetică decât de creșterea și consolidarea capacității sau poziției de piață? Pot fi folosite aceste două concepte împreună? Avem finanțatori care ar dori să vină alături de fondurile europene cu garanții sau poate cu alte surse de finanțare? Cred că este un moment oportun să discutați aceste aspecte și vă urez succes și vă promit că ori de câte ori veți avea nevoie de Ministerul Fondurilor Europene, ne veți găsi și vom fi parteneri de încredere, așa cum am fost de-a lungul anilor. Vă mulțumesc tare mult și vă urez o zi fructuoasă!
Mulțumim frumos! Doamne și domnilor, începem evenimentul de astăzi, invitându-i pe speakerii noștri dialogul la prezidiu. Alături de mine,
and this Clean Energy for All package actually comprised a revision of several pieces of legislation at European level. Energy efficiency, the energy performance of building directives, of the energy efficiency directive, which I'll refer a little bit more in detail, but not only that, also the renewables directive, also the electricity market design, both the directive and the regulation, because the reality of the energy system, and one of the major challenges we have into the energy system, is in addition to competitiveness, to price volatility, to sustainability, is the technology one. It was much more simpler 20 years ago, to have the energy system in balance, to keep the lights on when we have 20 technologies. We have coal, we have hydro, we have dots of some nuclear and so on. The energy system nowadays, distributed generations become a reality. A number of new technologies brought costs down. We see for renewables, the cost of renewables, the capex at least, going so much down that now the real challenge is the integration of renewables. So therefore, new technologies are coming to the picture, like storage. And here we see fast developments. Batteries increase cost with 70% just in 5 years. And this trend is going to continue. And there are other technologies coming into the picture, hydrogen, fuel cells, other storage technologies like compressed air and so on. So all this makes that the energy system is becoming much more complex. And we really need to find together the ways of making this operation and putting the best solutions in place, also at local regional levels. So, therefore, the dimension mentioned before by Mrs. Toiler, the Secretary of State, when she underlines the need for smart specialization is indeed very, very important. Now, how we move on all these aspects, we clearly need to work on creating the internal market, on pushing the renewables and the making a new market design briefly, which renewables, which are going to represent in power generation at EU level perhaps 50% by 2030. Markets are designed for renewables, but also renewables are designed to play on a level playing field with both rights and obligations in the markets. They are not a minor technology, they become a major technology, all of them combined. But energy efficiency stays at the center of our activities. It is what we call energy efficiency first, and for this reason, I would like just to briefly show you that we succeeded. We succeeded at European level, and I think this is very important. From 2005 to 2014, you have the evolution here of the final energy consumption. And you see that it decreased. Now, there are a number of factors. So, for example, due to activity, it increased a bit, not so much, because of the problems we had with the economic crisis in the 2008. We had an increase due to the demography, to the lifestyle, there are more computers, bigger houses, and so on. We had a significant decrease due to the energy savings. And this can be seen, and this is a big success of the policies, of the measures we put in place, and the implementation efforts made across the member states. And this is needed to continue. Therefore, energy efficiency, we really looked in the new package to try to have not only targets, but also to have a number of measures, in particular for the most important consuming sectors, for building renovations, for energy efficiency investments, in order to achieve the objectives we have for 2030 and the decarbonization objective for 2050. Consumers have moved much more into the center stage of the energy system. They also have more abilities to interact with the energy system, due in big part to the ICT technologies, we speak about prosumers. Then the cost of a number of renewables went down, so they allow consumers to play sometimes as prosumers, but we have to ensure that this is done in a cost-effective way and the overall energy system is kept in balance and the overall society costs are also optimized. Therefore, we have a number of provisions also on how to integrate renewables on the consumer side with buildings, and these elements are very important for the future. To support this, and now all the package and the targets and all that is under negotiation in the Council and the Parliament, which I have to say very good hopes, because for example the EPBD is quite advanced, and the EED will start the trilogue soon. But what I have to say is that, of course, we'll need also to support investments into these areas and to make this happen. This is not a cost, I need to underline that, it's an investment into the energy transition and in the end should pay back to the society. If we look, and we had the presentation before the words from the Ministry of Regional Development, on energy efficiency in the regions, there are significant amounts of funds which are allocated for improving energy efficiency. At European level, in the current period, we have doubled compared with the previous period, 2007-2013. So now we speak for low carbon economy, over 45 billion euros are allocated for energy efficiency, for renewables, for smart grids, distribution level, and for also urban mobility. And we see that, for example, the case of Romania is over 1 billion euros, which are in principle allocated for residential and public buildings for improving energy efficiency. Significant amount of money also in the other countries mentioned here, and which are what we call CESEC countries. CESEC countries from the EU region, because involved in the CESEC regional cooperation, of course, also other countries who are not currently in the EU, but for which is very important part of the neighborhood policy to advance, and therefore we work closely with the Energy Community Secretariat for the Western Balkans and the other countries. This sounds a significant amount of money, and it is indeed a very important amount of money which are allocated for energy efficiency to really drive efforts in this area. Allow me to show you the next graph where the order of magnitude change. And the order of magnitude change is because if we want to achieve the 2030 targets, we need to invest in the range, you have the scenario called ZU for 2030, 379 billion euro per year between 21 and 2030 at European level in whatever is energy transition, energy investments. Separately, you see a much bigger blue line, which includes also the transport part. Now, to get to 317 billion, therefore, this is not just energy efficiency, it's also renewables, it's grids, it's everything else. But it's a significant, a huge amount of money, which we cannot achieve just with the structural funds, or we cannot achieve just with public funds. It's absolutely essential to achieve this leveraging, to invest and to have the private sector, to have individuals convinced, committed, supported, and finding actually a business case for these investments in order to take place in all the sectors, and in particular also in energy efficiency, which is happening everywhere at all levels of all consumers. So, therefore, we have launched the so-called initiatives, and we are in the process of promoting this initiative, smart finance for smart buildings. Buildings are still an extremely important component of the energy system. 40% of the energy is consuming buildings. And the penetration of renewables in this sector is not so easy as you have seen penetration of renewables, for example, just in power generation. So we have to create a number of synergies between these sectors. Therefore, we speak about sector integration. But we also have to take measures to moderate the energy demand and to make energy efficiency really a priority. How to spend money most effective? This is what we speak smart finance for smart buildings. And it's on three pillars we try to develop. More effective use of public funds, this is the first. Then assistance and aggregation to support project pipeline at EU and local level through also project development assistance. And de-risking, because the perception of the risk is important both for the project development.
I am representing DG Regio. Sorry, my level of Romanian is so poor I cannot speak in Romanian, but maybe in 3 years' time I will manage if we redo the same conference. In fact, DG Regio is a very strange directorate general, because our role is to promote regional development, of course, with a large amount of money. But we are not acting in isolation. We are acting with the policy side, represented by Mr. Constantinescu here in the GNR, but we are also working with the national and regional side, in that case, Hungary, Bulgaria, and Romania, based on sound national or regional need assessments. So this is a very interesting DG, and I'm very happy to show you some elements. We can next. Yeah. I will not impose some figures to you. This is just to show you how cohesion policy is working at regional level. So this represents quite a large amount of money. This is, and now we are in the middle of the 2014-20 period. And as you can see, the entire envelope for this period is 4,054 billion euros, which is quite large amount. And out of it, the idea of these funds are to deliver through multiple channels. And of course, the idea is to support the regional development, national and regional development, through co-financing. So the idea is to invest, to redistribute EU funds at national and regional level. In different ways, we have grants, of course, grant schemes, subsidies, but also financial instruments which can be developed. This implementation is quite unusual because it relies a lot on the national and regional structures. This is what we call shared management. The Commission, which in that case I represent with DG Regio, has only part of the power for implementation. The main part stays with the states. The member states. This figure, I told you I will not impose too many figures, but I think this is important to realize that there is a political commitment both from the side, from the Commission, and from each country to focus on energy. And in that case, you can see that the amounts proposed to be invested in energy efficiency for this period are quite substantial compared with the previous period. In addition to this effort, each country has a specific need. Based on need assessment, each country can allocate the funds on different topics. And definitely, public building and residential building renovation, energy efficient renovation, of course, is a major issue. That's why the structural funds have definitely increased this share for renovation, energy efficient renovation. Mrs. Toader mentioned it already. In Romania, you have 1 billion euro allocated to this goal. Of course, energy efficiency shall be seen also in not in isolation again, but together with all the means to reduce energy consumption. Of course, deep renovations, it's important, but you are also public lighting, but we have also smart grids, smart generation of energy, and more generally, sustainable development of urban areas has to be taken into consideration. Now, what is at stake is we are in the middle of the financing period. What is at stake is the implementation. So, the money is there. Now it's time to implement and to spend the money on concrete projects. Only this implementation will make a difference on the ground for the citizens. And money on a paper, which is important because this is the commitment, has to be translated into concrete projects which benefits the citizens on the ground. And now this is time for it. Advantage and disadvantage of energy efficient projects are they are long lasting projects. It starts and over a certain period of time. That's why it's important to start as soon as possible. Well, this is data. Just to show you this is the allocation for energy efficiency in Hungary, well, in all countries, but for example in Hungary, Bulgaria, and Romania. And you can see that it's quite significant for a residential building renovation. The same for public buildings. There is a huge effort from the countries to allocate significant amounts of money on this area. I told you that there are two types of financing schemes. You have grants, you have financial instruments. We may discuss later some other elements, but we should not forget, because these grants and financial instruments are complementary. They are not serving the same goal, they are not serving the same public, but they are complementary and can contribute to develop projects. Because, of course, financial instruments are not adapted to all types of projects. This is an illustration how also of the complexity which is needed to master, to have, you need to have the capacity for mastering this complexity, but it has benefits in the end. Last but not least, Mr. Constantinescu mentioned FC. Be careful. We have ESIF, well, it's an English acronym, ESIF for structural funds, and FC. FC is the investment plan, the so-called Juncker plan. And these can be used in combination for leveraging the projects. I come to my conclusion, I'm almost in time. So I would like to insist again, there is a huge effort, a political commitment for energy efficiency in this over this period of time, to invest and propose investments, at least available money for this type of investments. And this is important, that this money is used and for the citizens, and to be converted into real projects. There is also, from the Commission side, a continuous support from the policy side, from the regional development side, for energy efficiency, but also renewable energy, of course, because these are the two pillars. Make the most of the instruments existing. So far in Romania, there are, for example, very limited examples of financial instruments for energy efficiency. Maybe this is time now to think and see how these instruments can be combined with the current existing schemes. Please, I repeat again, we are halfway through the financing period 2014-2020. Now it's time to deliver. It's time really to see the concrete implementation and the translation of a figure on a paper, on an operational program, what we call it, into concrete realizations. And this is your job, basically, because the concrete implementation is done at regional level. Of course, maybe not your job personally, but you all here, you will contribute and you will increase the rapidity, and you will facilitate this uptake. And don't forget that we have a commitment now for this period, and it's time to focus on this period, but we need to think into the future. Mrs. Tovada hinted some elements to discuss, and because the new framework for regional development will be negotiated very soon. In 1 year time, the negotiation will start. So it's time also for you here to think, reflect, and propose elements for the discussion, so that the Romanian authorities have concrete elements, concrete needs, and be able to assess these needs and propose solutions. So don't focus only on this period, of course it's important, but also think ahead about this. I thank you because my time is up.
Our next speaker is Mr. Martin Schoenberg to deliver a presentation about mobilizing the financial sector on energy efficiency. Please, Schoenberg, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So I work for UN Environment's Finance Initiative, which is a partnership between the United Nations and about 240 major financial institutions. So we work with banks mainly, but we also work with quite a few of the major investment funds in the world and of course also with insurance companies. And essentially we have been discussing with our members what drives your interest into energy efficiency, because there is strongly vested interest. And what we essentially came up with in the discussions with our membership base is that there are several major drivers of increasing investor interest, but this also actually applies to banks, as well as to a certain extent insurance companies. And the major drivers of this, the first one of course is fiduciary duty that sits at the center of all of investors' considerations. So it essentially means that they have to fulfill a risk return, there needs to be an adequate risk return relationship, and normally energy efficiency actually when you look closely enough, very comfortably fulfills those requirements. Of course, there's still some further work required. And it's also participating in technological development. It's an energy price hedge. And we know now that fossil fuel prices are going up again. energy efficiency also protects against that volatility inherent in some of the wholesale market prices. It is also, of course, a way of capturing a value premium in real estate particularly, so it's a way of capturing, especially in the sort of green building segment, but increasingly also in the mainstream, it drives a value premium and therefore is also of interest to investors. However, all that said, and also said that investors now have an increasing interest in this topic, we're still quite far away from realizing the full potential of energy efficiency. So if you look at this data on the right, you can see that there's a large unrealized potential in projections up to 2035. The highest untapped potential is in the building sector, but there's also a significant untapped potential in power generation and distribution, in transport, and also, of course, in industry. In industry, things are actually moving ahead a bit more smoothly, but still there's a huge untapped potential. So overall, things are encouraging though. This is not a niche market, this is actually quite a major market. Energy efficiency is now globally on par with renewable energy in terms of total new investment every year. So that makes about 230 billion of investment flowing into energy efficiency every year. And that is also almost on par with grid investment, so it's really a major component of overall energy markets now. However, still in order to realize the objectives of the Paris Agreement, and of course speaking for the United Nations, that is something that is very dear to me, to our organization, we still need to increase the rate of global energy intensity improvement by a factor of 8. So there's a huge leap required, and that can only work if we leverage private sector capital. So if you look at the rate of global energy intensity improvement, you can see that from a very low base in the sort of early 2000s, we have now reached sort of 2% improvement of global energy intensity every year, and that is going up according to projections to even 2.53%. So it is a significant acceleration of energy intensity improvement, but we're still not fully on track. So then when we talk to our members, and also this is based on some certain research, I have to add to that, we sort of looked at, so how can we transform this market? So how can we essentially move from energy efficiency being a component of a large chunk of real estate transactions, a large chunk of industrial financing activity, but still not being a complete mainstream activity? And there are four challenges that essentially come to mind. The first one is that energy efficiency, especially when you compare to renewable energy, is actually quite complex to do. That has to do with the fact that energy efficiency, I mean, renewable energy most often is done, I mean, there's some yield curve approaches, but generally it's done through project finance. So it's done, you know, through through a loan attached to a concrete renewable energy project. It's a very not straightforward, but it's a standardized market practice. Now, energy efficiency, because it's across sectors, so it's not only in the, you know, it's not only in the building sector, it's also in industry, it's in transport and so on. And even within the building sector, you have to distinguish between, of course, a new build and a refurbishment. So there's a wide range of financing structures which are necessary for investments across sectors and asset classes. Deal size is small, and crucially, energy efficiency is most often embedded into other transactions. So energy efficiency normally doesn't get done as a standalone investment, it gets done as part of an overall, for example, building refurbishment or a large commercial new development. So for this reason, energy efficiency is always integrated into other investment activity. And finally, there's a need for coordination and standardization across actors. So how can this mainstreaming of energy efficiency be done? And this is actually a chart which was shown at a sort of conference, and I adjusted it to this context here in order to show you the role of concessionary finance, guarantees, but also shared standards. And you can see as you move from essentially you kickstart the market by subsidizing, so like with concessionary finance, that improves the risk return, that leads to a situation in which investors of course become very interested in banks because the risk return relationship is very favorable. But then as you move towards more towards mainstream market practice, you start working on guarantees. So you don't actually, you just reduce the risk a little bit and you make sure that essentially these guarantees can drive forward investment levels. And then finally what you want to arrive at as you move to market mainstreaming is that you arrive at shared standards. And that's actually something that if you look at the high-level expert group on sustainable finance that is also the European Commission is also spearheading, that is something they're looking very closely in the context of green bonds. But of course this is overall a key component that you...
Thank you very much. So I represent the Department for the Energy Policy in the Ministry of Energy, and I can tell you that energy efficiency is indeed one of our main priorities. At the same time, we have to admit that energy efficiency is also a very complex issue and objective to reach. Because, as it was said here before, it's time to deliver, and to deliver, there is a need to an effort and good cooperation among all the stakeholders involved, from central authorities to local authorities, regulatory authorities, private sector, and most important, consumers. Because energy efficiency is, at the end of the day, related to consumers and is addressed to consumers. So let's see the situation in Romania. We have target for 2020. In renewables, we have for renewables we have 24%, and we can proudly say that we have already reached this target. In energy efficiency, the target is 19% for 2020, and according with the National Commission for Prognosis, there are estimations that we can reach this target, but of course with efforts. And for 2030, there will be a need for much bigger efforts from all of us. It's maybe energy efficiency target will be 30%. I say maybe because we know that this target is not established yet. It will be an output of a trilogue between the European Council and the European Parliament. Our primary legislation in Romania, so the directive for energy efficiency was implemented by law in 2014, and this law of course established the legal framework to develop and implement the energy efficiency measures in order to reach our objectives in this sector. And through this law, it was established within the National Authority, Regulatory Authority, Special Department for Energy Efficiency, with the task to coordinate and monitor the progress done in this sector. And of course, for sure, the presentation for our regulatory authority will speak more about this department task. And National Action Plan for Energy Efficiency is done, as everybody knows, every 3 years. And now Romania is in process to approve by government decree the action, National Action Plan number 4. And we hope it will be adopted soon. And also in the law, there are alternative policy measures which consist of mandatory obligation, yes, for beneficiaries to make audit, energy audits for the one who have consumed annual total primary consumes higher than 1,000 TEP per year. Metering and billing, consumer information programs and training. As I said, the energy efficiency measures, energy efficiency is addressed specifically to consumers, and they have to be aware, and we have to raise awareness through training and information programs about the benefits of these measures. System of qualification, accreditation, and certification, and also support of and development of ESCO, energy service companies, which I consider they should have a bigger role in addressing all the issues. Our primary energy intensity, it's 2 times higher than the value of this indicator for the EU 28 average, so Romania needs to make further efforts to reduce the primary energy intensity. And the sectors with the greatest potential for reduce or increase energy efficiency, as we can see from this chart, is the building sector, followed by transport, services, and industry. Now, let's speak about final solutions, because this is the subject of our this conference. There are programs. Important program is operational program for large infrastructure, which allocate approximately 12 billion euro to projects for promoting clean energy and energy efficiency, to support low carbon economy, and also to support projects for increasing energy efficiency in district heating sector. Then there is a regional operational program for 2014-2020, which allocates approximately 8 billion euro from European Fund for Regional Development, the co-financing state budget, addressing the projects for increasing energy efficiency in residential buildings and also in transition to a low carbon economy. As I said before, involvement of energy services companies, ESCO, in the design, implementation, or co-financing of projects, it's a key issue. I can say, because this ESCO could assist the beneficiaries in making, establishing a valid and good project, and try to help in financing. At the Romanian level, we have specific at Romanian, we have some programs, specific programs, which do not provide a huge amount of money, but they are good programs that are addressing in the sector, they are targeting the sectors which is a much needed effort. So we have the Romanian Fund for Energy Efficiency, the program Innovation Norway, and the Energy Efficiency Financing Facility. This, the last one, being a line of credit based on grants from European Commission and EBRD funds, which is facilitated by six Romanian banks. And of course, these projects are addressing or estimates results are in reducing energy consumption, fuel consumption, and
improving energy experts can help consumers in energy efficiency issues. SMEs and local governments can save energy and cut costs by free energy consulting service. Reduction of 5 or 15% in annual energy consumption can be achieved without any investment cost in all central and municipal public buildings by energy efficient facility management and adopting low cost measures. The National Energy Efficiency Advisory Network is established at territorial administration level to ensure the network's compatibility and availability for consumers. In order to reduce establishment costs, the network is operating at government offices of the cantons in the capital as well as in district government offices of towns with more than 200,000 inhabitants. It includes the establishment of more or less 100 energy advisory offices. The energy office fulfills specifically defined responsibilities and will be integrated into the organization of government office. That's why it is not necessary to provide separate office space or infrastructure. It is expected to employ 2 engineers per 1 office. The network is to be supervised by the Minister of National Development. Mandatory periodic training should ensure the achievement of appropriate professional results. National Energy Efficiency Advisor Network is set up and working and started working by 1st of January 2017. The network should perform not only consulting but also controlling, monitoring and mandatory reporting tasks which are necessary for collecting energy savings data derived from the specified policy measures like collection and control of energy consumption data of central and public municipal institutions. Article 5 of Energy Efficiency Directive requires member states to renovate existing buildings of central government institutions up to the current minimum energy performance. It refers to cooled or heated buildings used and owned by the central government. It includes 89 buildings in Hungary. So the result of the measures, this thing will not be significant, but this measure is mandatory according to the directive as you know. From 1st of January 2017, all companies with large energy consumption will have to employ an energy officer in order to monitor energy and energy consumption and help energy efficiency. And the local government may also be obligated to use the energy expert if it has a business organization and reaches the consumer values specified in the law. You can see the values on the slide. Employment of such expert helps the spread of energy efficiency and related behavior patterns in organization operation and decision making. According to international experiences, the employment of energy consultant or officers results 1% to 3% reduce of energy consumption. This is the most popular measures in Hungary. We got a lot of phone calls from enterprises which are interested in details of these measures. The Corporate Tax and Dealing Tax Act has been amended and tax relief guaranteed for energy efficiency investments. On this basis, if a company implements energy efficiency investments, the company becomes eligible either to a one-time tax benefit in the year after the investment has been implemented or 5 years incentives. And the maximum tax incentive is 15 million euro or 30% of the investments, which can be increased by 20 million euro and 40% in case of small and medium-sized enterprises. And the incentives is available for investments that have started after 1st of January 2017. The tax will be available on the basis of energy efficiency certificates. The certificate must therefore relate to the investments certificate of the, sorry, investment, So the certificate has a project agreement concerning the energy efficiency targets. The cleaning tax relief, mobilization certificate of the quality management, quality of investment, the taxpayer registration, and reported obligation will have special relevant degree. The fulfillment of the condition requirements of the tax benefit will be checked at least once by the end of the third fiscal year after the first year of the tax benefit by the tax authority. The measure is primarily designed to improve the competitiveness and the energy efficiency of small and medium-sized enterprises. We know the companies, if there is any opportunity for investments, prefer the short-term measures for investments, no more than 3 years, and are hardly starting any medium or long-term investments, more than 5 years. Long-term investments are only considered if there is any additional support. And we think the corporate tax incentive can be a new measure to realize investments with 5 to 6 years of return. And finally, in this aspect, I would like to highlight some marginal but related measures in Hungary. For example, the Work Home Birth of Home program. This aims to reduce household energy costs and address energy poverty. Among other things, the program had replaced outdated and inefficient household boilers, measures that also contribute to fewer GHG emissions. The other program is the Modern City program, was set up to promote 23 cantons. It aims to support cantons to become centers of rural development, improving driving conditions, as well as renovating roads, squares, and of course buildings. And finally, the operation programs are designed to support certain areas and sectors of economy related to renewable energy sources, energy efficiency, and reduction of GHGs. These operational programs for the period between 2014 to 2020, their aims and indicators are approved by the EU Commission. The programs are to support energy efficiency and to foster renewable energy sources by providing the development framework of 2.5 billion euro during this high development period, creating a solid foundation for the energy efficiency developments of the next years and reaching the 2020 targets. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your
presentation. The clean energy for our Europeans package. Something that has already been touched upon by the European Commission, Mr. Constantinescu. About 3 years ago, we tried to create an interinstitutional council for coordinating energy efficiency measures in the country, but we failed to do so. So there are a number of ministries, institutions responsible for energy efficiency measures. As regards operational programs, innovations and competitiveness for the current period, 2014 to 2020, is under the Ministry of Economy. There are measures directed towards energy efficiency of industry there. There are measures for improvement of energy efficiency in buildings with the Ministry of Regional Development and Public Works. There the colleagues develop a program for renovation of buildings of households, and they also have measures in the operational program regions in growth. With the Ministry of Energy, we are managing, as you see my position, I'm the directorate responsible for energy projects. And the projects that we are managing are
under the so-called Kids Fund, that is a compensation for early closure of units of the nuclear power plant at Kuzluduy. We also have measures under the so-called Norwegian program. It was mentioned by the Romanian Director General already. This is the financial mechanism of the European Economic Area with measures for improvement of energy efficiency and deployment of renewables. We also have a long time ago established the Bulgarian Energy Efficiency Fund. Now it covers renewables as well. But later in the afternoon, in one of the parallel sessions, this topic is to be discussed, so I'm not going to further talk about it. And I have chosen to share with you some good experience with energy efficiency measures, and measures that are not 100% grants, because you realize that having 100% grants that we had under the Kids Fund or under the Norwegian program spoils the introduction of ESCO companies and other financial mechanisms. Good experience that we've had is with the credit lines at joint initiatives of the government with the EBRD, the EU and the Kids Fund. More specifically, these are the RECO, the BRECO, the BECIFF and the EU EFF. The first two ones that I'm going to talk in more details about are credit lines complemented by funds from EBRD and from the Kids Fund. The third one involves parallel grant co-financing from the EU structural funds, and the fourth one is similar to a measure mentioned by the Romanian colleague. This is a picture from EBRD website. This is the typical structure of Bulgarian sustainable energy efficiency funds. You can see here that EBRD grants money to partner local commercial banks, and there are two consultants involved in the implementation of measures and in the verification mechanism of measures. This is the technical assistance part, and there is also some incentives granted to both the banks and the final beneficiaries for good performance of projects. RECO is for residential buildings, energy efficiency, with the aim to help Bulgarian households reduce their energy bills and consumption. And the grant level is from 10 to 20% incentive towards the cost of the eligible energy saving projects, either in one or two family houses or in more than three dwellings. In the case of more dwellings, the level is higher. This credit line is still open. Applications can be submitted by the 31st of December this year, and measures have to be implemented by the end of next year. But I would like to share some results of the latest tranche, the last tranche that was launched on the 1st of September last year. And this is data for a period of 1 year from the end of December until